Hi guys. So I've got a 30-minute rapid game to share with you today, which has been submitted by a follower on chess.com. So playing with the black pieces is JP Finger, and they are playing against Eldexo. So JP is rated 825 as we speak, and Eldexo is rated just over 1,000. So this would be a good win. So he got on to me, he or she got on to me, and said, this is a game I felt like I could have won, should have won, but where did I go wrong? So I think it can't be stressed enough at this level, at sub 1,000 especially, that simply taking your time and looking at the whole board and seeing what is loose on the board makes the difference in so many games. So what I think is that what I would really recommend is that, I mean, playing 30 minute rapid is great. That's a really good time control. It means that you can be involved in the game and that you've got time. Every single move, you have time to survey the whole board, look at what is undefended on your side, undefended and on pre, which means it's undefended and can be taken on the next move, and also do the same for your opponent. And very often that is just going to be enough, because these games tend to be lost, not won. So let's start going through the game, and we're just going to apply this principle, okay? So white opens e4. d7 is played, the pick defense. White follows up with d4 because he can, because the just moving a pawn to the sixth rank allows that. And then black comes out with f6 with a knight. So far, so good. White replies with the opposing knight, which is very, very common. And then black plays e5. Now, I'm not very familiar with this opening. It's not one that I play. It feels a bit quiet to me, and I like more aggressive things. But to me, it seems to me like now, if white takes on e5, black recaptures on e5, queen takes queen, and then the black king is forced to take the white queen and loses castling rights. And that's indeed what happens. Queen takes, king takes. Now the black king can't castle. So black is going to have to use more moves now to get that king to safety. Other than that, material is equal, and the board is still pretty simple. Black is looking at this pawn on e4, but it is defended by the knight on c3, so let's see how we continue. Good move from white brings the dark square bishop out, pinning the knight against the king. Another good response, knight comes out, these knights are now paired, they've got each other's backs, and white castles queenside, which is a very good move because it brings this rook here onto the completely open d-file. Now, black has a problem, as you can see, because if white at some point goes ahead and takes that knight with the bishop, this knight cannot recapture because the king would be in check. So black would be forced to recapture with the g-pawn, doubling his pawns on the f-file and leaving an isolated pawn there on the h-file. So this is something that black needs to deal with. He replies by trying to kick the bishop away. Bishop goes back to h4, and now you always have that question, am I going to play g5 and finish the job of kicking the bishop away? Black decides to do that, okay? So he's still got the option. His king side is still neat and tidy. He's got his A, B, C pawns all there. So he needs to be thinking something like maybe fianchettoing the bishop there, or because he can't move the knight right now. That's the problem. And the knight's in the way of the bishop's in the way of the rook, right? So you can see how all the way from the first like three moves of the game, black's problems started to emerge then. Okay, so the bishop has to move out of the way. Interestingly now, this bishop is looking at the pawn on e5. The pawn on e5 is only defended by the knight on d7, but the knight on d7 is pinned against the king. So, in theory, white could come in and take this pawn, and with with impunity because black cannot recapture. So this I think was a decent move. Black moves the king, maybe spots that, maybe spots this danger here. Now white cannot go ahead and take that pawn because he would lose his bishop. White brings out his other bishop into an attacking space. Black kicks the bishop again. I think that's probably okay. You know, he still wants to be thinking about getting this rook over and getting the king into safety, probably there on the king side, although something like g7 doesn't look too problematic. The bishop moves away. Now the bishop's looking at f7 and the king is the only defender of f7, so we just need to be careful. So this is what I'm saying now, from, you know, particularly in this middle game section, which is where games are so often decided, and the balance, you know, you're trying to tip the balance one way or the other. Think, what is undefended? So let's look at the board. Undefended pieces, g2 on white's side, if it lets me highlight it, which is not. Okay, so g2 there is undefended. This bishop is undefended. These pawns are actually okay. That pawn is defended by the knight. And there we go. And strictly speaking, this rook on h1 is undefended. On black's side, the knights are fine. Everything on the board, again apart from maybe this the two rooks, is defended. So black is in a fairly solid situation. Let's press on. Black has also used nearly 9 minutes, used 8.5 minutes so far. White has only used less than 3. So black pushes b5, again kicking the bishop away, and white decides to take with the knight. And now look, so these are the kind of moves that you really, really have to clamp down on. There's a risk here, okay? The risk is that the knight moves into c7 and forks the king and the rook on a8, okay? But the knight is on pre. Why doesn't black just go ahead and take the knight? But instead, black sees something else. He sees, oh, there's a loose pawn. I'll take a loose pawn, right? Don't ever play the first move that you see. Scan the whole board, okay? So let's look, you know, what is undefended? The knight is undefended. I can just go ahead and capture that material and go 2 material points ahead. Black doesn't notice that, but snatches 1 loose pawn, equalizing in material. And there we get the fork. King has to move. But again, look, black can take a rook. It's worth 5 points. But, okay, arguably, he goes ahead and takes the pawn and attacks a second rook. Although, yeah, the knight can potentially take that, but this is still pinned because the king's now moved back to d8 and the king cannot take this. So this is looking like a very sticky situation for black, and it's all his own doing because he should have taken the knight on the last move. Attacks the bishop. This is a reasonable move because this pawn is actually protected by both knights, so this knight on e4 as well as this pinned knight, so the bishop can't simply take. That would be foolish. And he brings a knight out. Why doesn't he grab the loose rook? Every single move. This guy's got 25 minutes on the clock. When you've got 25 minutes on the clock, you can make 1 minute per move. You can easily allow 30 seconds per move. He doesn't do it, right? He's clearly, just look, how many pieces are there on the board? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. How long does it take to look at 11 pieces and to say to yourself, can I take that? Is it undefended, right? It's not going to take you more than 11 seconds, that's for sure. So for some reason, white moves a knight out. What black should be doing at this point is moving that rook on a8 out of trouble, but instead plays dark squared bishop up to g7, which is unnecessary because this bishop can't take that pawn. His other option was taking the blooming bishop as well. That's an idea, although that would bring the knight in, and then you've got the knight and the rook looking at this knight, but it's still not too bad. But yeah, it should be, what material can I take? What material can I protect? So white goes ahead and grabs the rook, which black had ample opportunity to defend. Black jumps in and grabs the bishop with the pawn. Black also here, look, has a nice fork there on both rooks. So white at this point is 3 material points ahead. White moves one of his rooks out of trouble. Black could still have jumped in and grabbed a pawn and attacked this other rook at this point, but instead moves the bishop there to attack the knight. The knight is actually trapped now, because he can't go to b6 because of this pawn on a7, and he can't go to c7 because the king will take it. So he moves that, but leaves his knight undefended. He should have just captured on f2, or you know, any other move to protect that knight, because the knight on a8 is trapped, so he's not in a hurry to capture that. So white captures, and instead of capturing the loose material, black decides to come in and triple defend. No, it's not triple defended, because yeah, this pesky knight is still pinned. So maybe moving the king out of the way would be sensible. So he double defends this pawn, which is double attacked. White moves the bishop out of the way. I'm not quite clear what the point of that is. And black finally recaptures the knight. So at this point, white is still 3 material points ahead. He's an exchange up, which means that he's exchanged a rook for a minor piece. The rooks are worth 5. The knights and bishops are worth 3. So he's an exchange up and a pawn up. But what I like about white's position is all of these pawns here are still in place. So they're nice and tight and respectable. Whereas black has big problems with his pawns. So he's got 1, 2, 3, 4 pawn islands. He's got these 3 completely isolated pawns and a pair there. So black's got his work cut out at this point. One thing I'd be thinking about maybe now is pushing c5, c6 to c5 would create a discovered attack on the rook and the knight. Although when the board's this open, you don't want to be exchanging bishops for knights, really. So what happens? You've got 2 attackers and 2 defenders on that pawn, which means that if white takes, black takes. White can't recapture because he's exchanging his rook for the bishop there. And so white would be winning a pawn and a minor piece in exchange for a minor piece and a rook. So he's just given the pawn away there. White comes in with a half of an attack against the rook. Rook pushes forward. Actually, at this point, I would have probably have advised moving the rook to e7 rather than e6. Yeah, on e6, okay, it's defending these 2 pawns on the 6th rank. But e7, it would have been out of touch. This, you know, on a dark square, it means that this remaining light square bishop couldn't have hassled the rook. But he moves there, and look, the bishop comes in and hassles it, so he has to move to e7 anyway. And now the bishop moves back. There's only 1 pawn difference at this point in the game. Black does push c5 with a discovered attack on the rook. Okay, white notices, that's fine. So now again, this pawn here on c5 is undefended because its only protector is this knight, which is still pinned. So the king moves out of the way. That's not bad, but it doesn't. It does stop the rook from taking now because the king's broken the pin. That's good. The pawn is pinned, so I think this is maybe a bit rash. B4 at this point isn't necessary. I think that white has the advantage of black's pawns being all scattered all over the board, so can start to use these powerful rooks. He's got 3 long range pieces. He's got 2 rooks and the bishop. Although he's technically down, so he is now a minor piece down, but a pawn up, so 2 pawns up and a minor piece down. So this is good. Black comes in with a check, forces the king to move. That wasn't a great move. I mean, it allows rook takes c5 with check. Okay. Now it is a fork, but if the rook then takes with check, the king is forced to move, and then the bishop can get out of the way. So it's not really a fork if one of the pieces can reply with check. King moves out of the way. Ah, okay, comes in with another check. King only has one move, b7. Now the bishop comes in to there. This is starting to look very, very threatening, but I think the right move at this point would probably be knight to c6. No, it wouldn't. That wouldn't work because there's two attackers, the rook and the bishop. So black moves out of the way. Maybe even knight to c6 now could work because there's a discovered attack on the rook with the bishop on f4. If the rook captures, then bishop captures, and you're down only one point there. So that's actually what black does. Decent move. Now, bishop takes. Okay. So white has a bishop hanging, but look, this is what the next move should be. Okay, should be bishop takes rook with the threat of bishop takes other rook, and that would actually be winning if he does it. So yeah, he takes the rook. That's absolutely great. So yeah, he takes the rook. That's great. White then responds with a pawn push. King can't take the pawn. King could actually move here, which is probably the best move. Yep, that's what he does. So again, now the rook is threatened twice. Rook moves out of the way. Rook defends bishop. Okay. Black could also be thinking about taking that bishop, because then if the pawn recaptures, king can recapture. So how are we looking right now? Material is technically equal. White has three extra pawns, but black has two bishops. I would prefer black's position at this point in the game. So because black moves there, he's leaving this bishop hanging. Okay. So in this position, I would have probably thought about capturing the bishop, and then if you know white recaptures, that's basically an exchange. But this is where black blunders a piece, basically. Now, this is interesting because the king has, if the rook comes to the back rank here, the king's only escape square is b2. Now, black has cleverly blocked off b2. So if white makes a mistake at this point, then the move is rook to e1, which would be checkmate. It wouldn't be checkmate straight away because white has rook to d1, but then rook takes rook, and that would be checkmate. So the game is now on a knife edge. C4, that's a decent move. This is giving the king another escape square on c2. King moves out of the way. I'm not clear why that is, because it's kind of, the king wants to be in the way of these pawns, wants to be blocking these pawns as much as possible. King moves into the game. King moves up the board. Bishop to c6. I don't really get that move, because again, look at the board. What's undefended? All the three of these, in fact, nearly all the pawns are undefended, and most particularly this one here on c4. King should take that piece. Okay, he does. That's great. Pawn moves forward. Pawn should take pawn now. Yes. So you can just see it's all being decided by loose pieces. Bishop moves back. Okay, this is limiting the king's options to a point. I mean, the king now can't go to any of these four squares. One thing I'd be thinking about at this point could be maybe simply rook to e2 with check. The king can't go to either of those two squares, but this pawn is grabbable. The next one could be risky because there's a potential of an attack with the bishop. But yeah, you should be thinking about hoovering up pawns at this point. So he moves there. Rook moves across, defending the most obvious loose pawn. This is a good move, comes in with check. The king only has b1 now to defend the pawn. Doesn't do that, moves to d1 instead. There's another check. This is a bit pointless, really, this check, I think. Because you've got options of maybe capturing this pawn here on a2, then move the king to d3, and then the threat is rook to a1 would be checkmate. This is a classic endgame checkmate. That's how you checkmate with a king and a rook. You get the king squared up two squares away from the other king, which is stuck on the edge, and then get the rook onto the king's rank, and that's checkmate. So that's what I would have done at this point, but he throws in an extra check for some reason, starting to press in. This is by no means a one-sided game at this point. This is anyone's game. This is a nice, tight, sharp endgame. And, okay, this isn't too bad. But black did leave the door open to this. You know, when you've got rooks on the board and mobile, then you do need to be thinking about, am I leaving pieces aligned with each other where I could be susceptible to a skewer in this case? So the king needs to move out of the way. But if rook takes rook, then at least the rook is defended by the bishop. So king moves out. Okay. Now, big mistake here. Right? The king should have moved to e2. Not here, because he's now in the way of the bishops. Now the bishop can't defend the rook. Moves there. King cannot recapture because he'd be moving into check. So I think that's you know, if you're going to say there was a point where the game was lost, I think that was the big blunder. How long did black take over this move? Let's look. 14 seconds, okay? Still got 4 minutes on the clock. That's just a blunder, really. You know, should have taken a little bit more time. So what I do in a situation like this is I go, you know, I'll pick up the piece and I'll move it to there, but I don't drop it. And I'll say, okay, is there anything? What's going to happen if I complete this move? Okay, rook takes rook. Can I recapture? No. Oh dear. Okay, how about if I go there? That's the way that I try and think. When I don't do that, sometimes I can make these kinds of blunders. Comes in with a check, but really the game is over now. A whole rook and a pawn advantage is going to be just too much, because the fact that white has a rook on the board means that white can now trap black's king into a sector of the board. Then allowing white's king and the bishop to shepherd these other pawns up the board and get a queen. That's pretty much how it works. Blunder. Huge blunder. White moves his rook in line with the black bishop. Does the bishop notice that the rook is there? No, he doesn't. Pushes b4 instead. This is why we say these are games that are lost, not won. King comes in attacking the pawn. Bishop defends the pawn. Pushes a pawn. And I think at this point, black resigns the game, which is appropriate. But yeah, again, you know, I cannot stress enough. And he's gone down to two minutes left on the board. On the clock, sorry. But again, you know, earlier on in the game, look out for those loose pieces. Are any of my pieces undefended? Are any of my opponent's pieces undefended? What can I take? Just take the time, scan the whole board, keep it simple. Just look at every piece on the board. Can I take this piece? Or if it's my piece, is it weak? Is it undefended? That's all you need to be doing at this point. There's some good chess being played here, some good moves being found, but there's some very, very clumsy ones as well. And that's what makes the difference.